And of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah! The Lord is risen!
Hallelujah! The Lord is risen! Hallelujah!
Very good. Together we have journeyed through the 40 days of Lent, through Holy Week, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, the Easter Vigil. And now we are all at the tomb. And something big has happened. Can you imagine how Mary Magdalene must have felt, and the Apostle Peter, and the beloved disciple? They're at the tomb, and they think that the body has been stolen. And they return to their homes. It's like coming to church and discovering, there's nobody here. There's no risen Lord. Let's just go home. But you all are here. Hallelujah. So they think the body has been stolen, and they return home. And John writes in the gospel, "For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead." How must they have felt in that moment? Not only had their rabbi been violently killed, their beloved master, now his body was missing. Everything had gone wrong. Beloved, how many times have we found ourselves in a situation feeling like that? Like God has abandoned us, or worse. And we get stuck there. We tend to get stuck there. We go home before we see the miracle. But Mary stayed. And she was weeping outside the tomb. She was just as upset as the others were. And the two angels and Jesus himself revealed to Mary. Jesus appears to her to remind her, and ultimately through her to all the disciples, and now to us, "Hey, what have I been saying? I told you I would be dead and I would rise again in 3 days. I'm alive. I'm resurrected." Okay, that's not in the Bible, but that's the gist. Yes, something big had happened. Something huge. Something life-changing. Something world-shifting. And that's not supposed to be the end of it. As Peter put it in Acts, he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. So, take this resurrection blessing for yourself. Experience it. And then pass it on. Share it. Live it. That's what Easter is all about. Now, when our brothers and sisters in the Eastern Orthodox Church celebrate the great vigil of Easter, they always hear the same sermon. And it's an ancient sermon from the 4th century. And it contains beautiful wisdom in its words about the implications of Christ's resurrection. It was originally preached by St. John Chrysostom. Now, Chrysostom means golden-mouthed, golden-throated. He was a great preacher, beautiful preacher, Archbishop of Constantinople, and an important early church father, who shaped and explained and promoted proper doctrine for and on behalf of the church. The sermon is simply known as the Paschal Homily. Homily. We didn't have homily Greeks, did we? Paschal homily. And apparently, for them, it never gets old. In several Anglican churches, and the first church that I attended as an Episcopalian, St. Patrick's, where Debbie was as well, We did this sermon one Sunday morning, and I thought it was something done all the time in Episcopal churches, so I'm going to do it again today. And we take this in the Episcopal Church because we believe there's often great wisdom in other traditions of our brothers and sisters who are in other fellowships or communions. And this ancient sermon talks about how Jesus, after he died, went to hell and completely disempowered it, leaving hell and its demons embittered. And that word, which you will see is repeated several times, simply means resentful. And that's the reaction, bitter, of someone who's been deceived or tricked. By the way, happy April Fool's Day. This is the greatest trick of all times. So this sermon is not just preached. There's a lot of audience participation. And so every time that I say the word embittered, you, if you're able, stomp your feet as loud as you can. Really stomp. And if I say embittered or dead or death, that's what you do. Stomp your feet. And that's just like Jesus stomped on hell. So when you hear also the word risen or raised, repeat it back as loud as you can. Let's try it. Risen.
Risen! All right.
So may we hear these words anew and afresh, just like this spring morning, just like this Easter day of resurrection. May they kindle in our hearts the Easter flame. So if you're able, please stand. And the text of the sermon is in your bulletin. Says the Paschal Homily. And it'll say where you're supposed to stomp. But let's listen carefully to this. If anyone is devout and a lover of God, let them enjoy this beautiful and radiant festival. If anyone is a grateful servant, let them rejoicing enter into the joy of their Lord. If anyone has wearied themselves in fasting, let them now receive recompense. If anyone has labored from the first hour, let them today receive the just reward. If anyone has come at the third hour with thanksgiving, let them feast. If anyone has arrived at the sixth hour, let them have no misgivings, for they shall suffer no loss. If anyone has delayed until the ninth hour, let them draw near without hesitation. If anyone has arrived even at the 11th hour, let them not fear on account of tardiness. For the Master is gracious and receives the last even as the first. He gives rest to him that comes at the 11th hour, just as him who has labored from the first. He has mercy upon the last and cares for the first. To the one he gives, and to the other he is gracious. He both honors the work and praises the intention. Enter all of you, therefore, into the joy of our Lord, and, whether first or last, receive your reward. O rich and poor, one with another, dance for joy. O you ascetics and you negligent, celebrate the day. You that have fasted and you that have disregarded the fast, rejoice today. The table is rich laden. Feast royally, all of you. The calf is fatted. Let no one go forth hungry. Let us partake of the feast of faith. Let all receive the riches of goodness. Let no one lament their poverty, for the universal kingdom has been revealed. Let no one mourn their transgressions, for pardon has dawned from the grave. Let no one fear death, for the Savior's death has set him free. He that was taken by death has annihilated it. He descended into Hades and took Hades captive. He embittered it when it tasted his flesh. And anticipating this, Isaiah exclaims, Hades was embittered when it encountered thee in the lower regions. It was embittered, for it was abolished. It was embittered, for it was mocked. It was embittered, for it was purged. It was embittered, for it was despoiled. It was embittered, for it was bound in chains. It took a body and came upon God. It took earth and encountered heaven. It took what it saw, but crumbled before what it had not seen. O death, where is thy sting? O Hades, where is thy victory? Christ is risen.
Risen!
And you are overthrown. Christ is risen.
Risen!
And the demons are fallen. Christ is risen.
Risen!
And the angels rejoice. Christ is risen.
Risen!
And life reigns. Christ is risen.
Risen!
And not one dead remains in a tomb. For Christ, being raised, from the dead, has become the first fruits of them that have slept. To him be glory and might unto the ages of ages. Amen. The Lord is risen.
The Lord is risen.